Flash Street. You guys know this Flash Street, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, well, Will, since there is audio, no family secret. Jane, you got the live stream going?
Yeah,
oh, there's Jane right there.
Hello.
Hi.
And throughout this night, I'm going to have each group's going to get a walkie-talkie. I'll also have one. Miss Janie will also have one. So we're all connected at all times if you see anybody needing anything. Now, for the live stream, that is up and rolling. So if you guys want to go get that link and send it to your friends and family, you can do that. I would advise after doing that to put your phones in airplane mode, as it will definitely interfere with the equipment. Thank you. if use it or don't. You know, this is your investigation. So everybody has that. Let's do okay two. Has anybody seen one of these before?
You've watched the ghost shows, you've seen it. It's kind of the most basic tool.
So this was made for contractors, electricians and such to find, you know, studs in walls. But we use it for ghost hunting because it's measuring EMF, it's measuring electromagnetic field, it's measuring energy, right? And so a lot of people put them down and they'll invite spirit to come forth and it will spike up, and that tells you, you know, that there's some form of energy that you're picking up on. And that's what you want to look for, is a spike, all right? Because if you're holding this and it, you know, maybe the light goes to yellow, meaning that it's picking up more energy. If it stays at yellow, that's not necessarily paranormal. That's your baseline reading. Because keep in mind, although we're investigating for ghosts, you know, what we're really doing is looking for what is scientifically unexplained. So that's kind of what you want to get with these. And so you can invite spirit to come closer to it. You know, maybe say get close to the green dot. That seems to be the best way to use these and get activity with these. Now, with this and with all of the equipment, I would really advise looking for intelligent interaction. So if you have this here and you're asking questions and it spikes once to one question, I'm not saying that's not paranormal, but what I'm saying is maybe ask the same question again, see if you get the same spike or the same answer. You know, ask, can you do that again? Can you spike it twice? You know, things like that. So then that kind of solidifies that a bit more, that you are intelligently communicating with them. So any questions on the K2s? No? Okay. We had a group the other night here, and they had the K2 sitting in the lower level of the mansion. They had a K2 in the lower level, and they were getting some activity. You know, they were getting some spikes. And they said, okay, can you back away? And it didn't spike for a while. And then they said, okay, can you go back? And then it spiked again. You know, things like that. I thought that was really neat. But let's see. Okay, so these, I'm really excited about. It's a really basic tool, but I'm excited about it because I really like this type of evidence myself. So this is a voice recorder. All right, and a lot of people use these in investigating because if you turn it on, you put it down, and maybe you're trying to communicate, and you're asking some questions, although you may not hear an answer at that time, when you play the audio back, sometimes there is a voice responding. That's a very common type of paranormal evidence. So when you're using these for that purpose, right, it's called an EVP, when you play it back and you hear what you didn't before, electronic voice phenomena, that's the term for it. But when you're using these, a couple things, right, you want to be careful of. So when you turn this on and you put it down and you're recording, one thing I always do is say, you know, I press record and I say, okay, this is me and 11 people and we're standing in the carriage house and it's about, you know, quarter to midnight, and, you know, then I go into it. Because I do that because when I play this back, I know exactly what's going on. You know, there's no question in my mind, you know, of where I am or anything like that. And also, if something happens to me, you know, in 10 minutes, you know, a crazy feeling or something like that, then I can go back on the recorder and I'll know which time it is and maybe it'll line up. You know what I mean? Like, if something happens on the recorder and also I'm feeling something at the same time, that further solidifies it, you know, that something strange was going on. I love when it happens like that, when the equipment can confirm, you know, what I feel or what I'm going through as well. Also with these, you probably want to mention everything that happens. Okay, so if I'm recording and I, you know, put my hand down and I don't realize that makes a noise, I just put my hand down, but I probably want to say in the recorder, oh, that was me, I just put my hand down. Because when you're playing this back, you're not going to remember that you did that, and you're going to say, oh, that's a weird noise, what was that? You know, you guys watch Ghost Hunters specifically? Kind of, some of you? Well, Steve Gonzalez from Ghost Hunters, he always tells me, I leaned back in the chair. You know, and so that was really helpful to him that he had that. So be careful of that. But these are sort of super cool tools, really simple, but really cool. So, when you're using this, there's one button on this side, right? That's the button that turns the recorder on. So if you hold it up, like take it and hold it, then this little digital display here will come on. And then you can let go, you know it's on. On the other side, all you need to worry about is the top button, the longer one, right here. See that? So this button, when you flick it up, it's going to stay, and that means you're recording. That's how you start recording, and it will stay on the display as well. So that's when you start recording. You push it back down, it'll click back down, and then you stop recording. I would suggest not recording an 18-minute EVP session. Maybe just a couple minutes here, a couple minutes there. Because keep in mind, you know, when you're going back through this, that might be a lot, you know. I don't know, you can always take breaks when you're going back through it, you know. And when you are going back through it, I would suggest maybe some over-ear headphones and maybe a dark environment just so it blocks out other stimuli and you're only concentrating on one sense. And of course, you know, the volume turned up as well. There's different lanyards on these so that when you finish your investigation and you give this back, I will take your email if you like, and then I will email you the recordings that you took. You can go through all of those. So there's that. Any questions on the recorder?
Experience with those is that you can tell because it does sweep across, you know, as it's scanning, and the voice continues over that, you know. Sometimes you can't understand it with your ear, but when you listen to the recording, you can. And also, too, if you get a response on that, it's usually, I mean, you're going to know immediately that that was not a voice on the radio coming through.
Yeah, because you're sitting there listening to this, and then something different happens, and it, you can, you know, our sensory input can tell
that. That gets a little annoying, you know, but then when you get that first response from it, you're like, oh my God, and you, you know, it you can absolutely tell the difference immediately.
Pretty crazy. I love those now. Hate them at first, but then I
just need to let it scan it, basically.
Yeah, yeah, just leave it scanning, and hopefully you get some communication. Okay, so all of the equipment that I've given you so far is yours to take with you whenever we change. You know, that's yours to keep for the investigation and use to your advantage. These items are the stationary items that will be set up for you to use for interaction, but just to leave where they are. So this is an EDI, okay? Got a couple different things going on here. This will be set up from the first level to the, or sorry, the second level to the third level on the stairs. All right, and I'll tell you why. So first of all, it has a digital display of the temperature. See that? Now, we position it so the camera can see, you know, so you can go back and look at the live stream if you need to for that, but the camera can't quite capture the digital display of the temperature, unfortunately, just so you know. But it's got an EMF right here as well, so like a K2 built in. It also has a geophone, and that's kind of the main reason that we're using this. It's picking up all this energy over here. So it's got a geophone in the very bottom. This right here. Hang on, let me make sure that it doesn't need a battery issue. I don't know why it's acting like that. Okay. Alright. So the geophone right here at the bottom. You see it light up? So what it's doing is it's picking up seismic activity, picking up vibration. So the reason that we're setting it where we are on the stairs up there is because we get a lot of reports from that area of footsteps. So if you're in that area investigating, you hear some footsteps, maybe you want to run out and see if this is capturing it. It's very sensitive. So that'll be set up for you. This right here is a really cool piece of equipment. We have a lot of interaction with these, as opposed to some other things. So there'll be one of these set up in each section for you. Right? One here, one on the sofa on the second floor, and one in a special room that's down here on the first floor, my favorite room. So this is measuring EMF as well, except this one is putting out its own field of it. Okay, so keep that in mind. You know, maybe you don't want to get the K2s too close to this because it will kind of mess it up. But so it's projecting its own field right here, and when you break that field, as you see I'm doing, it'll let you know with different degrees of intensity. Right? Looks like you're right on it. And so these are really cool for investigating because as it's set up, you can invite certain, you know, you can say, can you get close to that red light? Can you get close to that metal rod? These are 18th, 19th century ghosts, so you probably don't want to say antenna. I don't know what you're talking about. So you can say, can you get close to that red light? And if something goes off and nobody's touching that, then you know, maybe you want to see if that really is something paranormal. A couple tips with these. If it's going off, we had this happen recently. It was on Halloween. We had a group up here in the carriage house, and this thing just started going crazy. They didn't understand why, so they said, okay, could you back up? And it stopped. And it stayed stopped. And they said, okay, on the count of three, can you get closer to it? And they counted to three, and I know that it went off because I heard them scream. And I've seen the ghost hunter do that, you know, count to three. I've seen them do that as well. So little tips like that. Also, you can ask a question and say, could you get close to it if yes is the answer, or, you know, if no is the answer.
attention to what you're feeling. You know, if you walk in a room and you don't feel good, walk back out. If anybody at any point feels uncomfortable at all in any form, please let me know. You know, if you need to step out for a minute, that happens a lot. There is some rooms, especially here on the lower level, a lot of people get uncomfortable in. So feel free to radio us and we'll come get you out. You know, you can take a break or whatever you need. I just ask that you please don't put yourself in any situation where you are uncomfortable. That's not good. That's not what this is about. Let's see. Okay, so for the live stream as well, folks, what we're going to be doing with that is Janie's going to be kind of zooming in on whoever is getting some activity. But I want to let you know that if you guys are getting some activity, and you guys are getting some activity, and maybe Janie zoomed in on you guys, but you guys want to see the video footage from that, just email me, and we can get that video footage to you. So we always have that, and that's a really useful tool for sure. So the sooner you email me, the better, because, you know, only her holds to a certain day. Let's see if I missed any tips here. Okay, so for when you're doing an EVP, when you're doing audio, one thing you can do is maybe sit in a group. You know, everybody kind of sit down together and just try to be quiet, try to be still. Don't whisper, right? Because when you go back and you're listening to that, if you hear some, you're going to be like, what's that? Who's that talking? You probably won't remember. One question and wait. When you're trying to communicate with spirit, you know, if you're sitting there asking a bunch of questions, it's confusing. You know, the best thing to do is just have one question, wait so you can get a response, wait to see if anything happens, and then ask another one. Also, easy questions. Obviously, whatever realm this is that we're communicating with, the communication line is not very good, so easier questions seem to work better and be the best choice. Let's see. Alright. Just one more thing before we head in the mansion. One more tip that I like to do is you can maybe try to get spirits to imitate you. Okay, so a lot of people with the rim pop, they'll say, can you do like this? Can you make it light up? You see how I'm doing this? You know, and they'll try to get imitation. They'll say, can you knock back? And kind of wait and see if they're getting a knock back. I keep waiting for one night I do that and then I get a knock back. Maybe the doors. You know, we, especially this past week, Kelly can attest to this. We have had a lot of doors opening and closing.
We've had a lot of doors opening and slamming.
You want to tell them what happened last night?
Well, we were celebrating New Year's here, and after the last tour left, we were all up on the balcony, and we cooked out, and done, you know, some hot dogs and sausages, and set up food on the table in the study, just, you know, about six of us hanging out here, and we had heard some noises earlier and just, you know, thought it was possibly, you know, something that we expected. Walking around the foyer, a door that, you know, I knew was closed when I went into the room and then went back in a minute later and the door was open. And I asked the two people sitting there, like, you know, did y'all open that door? No. So we went over and shut it. And then, you know, we have our, you know, celebrated midnight. We were here till about 2 o'clock in the morning. We were sitting in the study, not talking about anything specific. But we were talking about hauntings and spirits and things, but nothing specific here. And then we all leave, except what, 2:15?
Mm-hmm.
We're all leaving. We carried everything downstairs. There was just a couple of things for Annie to go back and get, and she needed to close the house up. And my husband and I, we're on our way home, halfway home, and I get a phone call from Annie. And she says, did y'all go back upstairs? Are y'all back upstairs? And I said, Annie, we're halfway home. And she was like, okay, well, Melissa and I came back up here to, you know, get the rest of that stuff and close up the house, and we heard footsteps and heard a door slam. Heard it downstairs first, and then thought it was upstairs, and we came upstairs, and now we hear it again, and it's downstairs. And we got on video. She's on the phone with me, and I hear her go, oh, my God, there it is again. And she said, Kelly, I think somebody's in the house. Not a dead person, but someone alive, you know. And I said, all right, we're turning around. So we come back, less than 5 minutes, we're back here, and of course my husband jumps out of the car, I park the car and follow him, he's upstairs checking every nook and cranny, and then as we figure out nobody's upstairs, there's nobody, you know, alive, except us, in the house, we go to come downstairs, and I was at the first landing, and we all hear a door slam downstairs, and as bit disconcerting, and it was like last night they got really, really irritated that we were here, and, you know, like we all left, and then she and Melissa went back inside, and they were like, oh, no,
mm-hmm.
You've already left, we want our house back.
Maybe you guys can try that, especially tonight, you know, try to see if you can get somebody to close the door or something. I had one guy recently on an investigation, it was really cool. The door was open, and he's doing an EVP session, and he says, well, let me just close this door so we can get some privacy. So he walks over the door, and he puts his hand on it, and he stops, and he goes, well, you know, this isn't my house, so why don't you try to close mine?
And, by the way, any of you ladies here, you may have earrings on, because I did have an earring taken, and it's not the first half an earring that I've had taken in this house, but I did lose an earring Thursday night here as well.
While she was wearing it.
Yeah.
I
because I've lost several here. Well, not hairs, half of the hair.
It's always a half.
It's really irritating.
It's always a half.
Yeah, I was not happy Thursday night.
I warned you. That's your own fault.
I know, but I didn't expect you to go in the house that night. I usually wear plastic backbone because she can't take them or here, wherever it is. And sure enough, because I checked my ears before I went in the house and came out and left one gone.
You didn't feel it?
No. I've never felt it. Any of the earrings I've lost, I've never felt it.
All right.
They can be quite annoying. Good. We're prepared.
Thank you.
room beautiful?
Yeah.
Is the face beautiful?
Yes, but see, here. If you do an EVP session, it might mess it up. So maybe you want to turn it off for a bit. Just let me know whenever we switch and we'll adjust or whatever. No worries. Okay. The parlors are pretty fun. You probably want to spend some time in here. The parlors have a very specific purpose for the Sorrell family, especially Matilda Sorrell, the lady of the house. All right? Matilda was known for one thing here in Savannah. She was known all over Savannah for her parties. They were so large, they were so extravagant, they would fill to the square next door. They would last through the night. She had all activities pre-planned for everyone to do. Okay, so for starters, instead of the furniture, she had a single table outstretched, length of the room here. And all kinds of food on it. Everybody would feast. Once everyone was full, they'd have the table removed, a band would set up, probably in this area right over here. Everyone would dance in these rooms. After the dancing, the men would retire back into this room. They'd have the furniture brought back in. The men would lounge and drink their brandy, smoke their cigars, talk their business and politics. All the while, beyond the closed pocket doors here, sat the ladies. They sipped their tea. They talked about life in Savannah, probably who's who at the time. Francis would entertain the men, Matilda entertaining the ladies over here. And on a couple of occasions, one such gentleman that did attend these parties, that did sit in this room, was none other than Mr. Robert E. Lee. That's why his portrait is on the wall. He was friends with Gilbert Moxley Sorrell. He did visit at the home. I don't think Robert E. Lee is here. If you want to try to communicate with him, be my guest. but a lot of times, you know, most reports that we get from these rooms are of the parties continuing on. Mm-hmm. We hear full conversations being held in here. We hear laughter, singing, ghost adventures. Guess what? Ghost Adventures on Travel Channel. They captured singing in these rooms while they were here in Dutch City. Music in the distance. We capture that on audio. And you know, everybody always wants to know what experiences we as a staff have had happen to us individually. One experience that stands out to me was when I was on a tour, and I was coming up the stairs here, and I was coming to the parlor room here, and I opened the door to the foyer, and when I do, I hear voices, okay? My first reaction is, oh my gosh, there's a tour in the parlors where I'm taking my tour. And the adrenaline in my body started reacting. And in those few seconds it takes me to get from that door to this door to the parlor, my brain is going crazy. You know, how am I going to handle this situation? This is terrible. Why is there a tour in there? Who is it? And by the time I open that door to the parlor, the voices immediately cease. And that scares me because in hindsight, I can't rationalize it. I can't say, oh, I didn't hear that. I reacted physically to that. So maybe do some audio recording here. I would highly suggest that. Mirrors. We get tons of photos sent in from guests. They're capturing images in these mirrors. There's one in each room over the fireplaces. Now, the images that are captured in here that are strange, you know, are images of people who weren't in the room at the time the photo was taken. Now, we know they weren't in the room because they're wearing old-style attire. Okay? It's ladies in Victorian and antebellum-style clothing, and it's men in Revolutionary and Civil War type attire. Maybe take the photos in the mirrors as well. I want to share with you all the most tragic story of the Sorrell Weed House. The Sorrell Weed House story. Let's head across here to Lady Parker, so I can go ahead and cut these as we go as well.
Now, the furniture in these rooms is okay to
set
on
them? Not on this furniture.
Okay.
This furniture here is very antique and fragile. We've had people, and I do this as well, just sit on the rug.
Okay.
Your discretion, of course, but you know, we
have the best chairs.
Yeah, they are. The back of that one is very visible. For a very long time. Okay, there was a big sense of family, obviously, you know, money issues, you know, very prominent in the community, but that came to a tragic end
as it does sometimes. It was March 27th, 1860, right? It was the day that the Sorrells were preparing for another of their famous parties. And Matilda, she's upstairs getting ready to greet all of her guests. Slaves are in these rooms, dressing the rooms, you know, for everyone to arrive. More slaves beneath us, preparing the meals for everyone to enjoy. So the house is above. There's a lot going on, and Matilda, amidst the chaos, wants to check in, make sure everything is running smoothly, right? So she goes to check with Molly. Now, Molly was the head slave of the Sorrells. So what this means is that Matilda would communicate with Molly everything that she wanted to get done. Molly was the one to dictate to the rest who's doing what, this is how we're doing it, and she is in charge in that way. Now, Molly's always around. For whatever Matilda needs, Molly is there. But on this day, when Matilda goes to look for Molly, she can't locate her. She searches the entire mansion with no sign of Molly. She walks out to the drive here. She's asking around, has anybody seen Molly? No one knows. Now, at this point, right, with Matilda standing outside, she knows something is wrong. She knows also that there is one place that she has yet to check for Molly. Molly had her own private room, which was located in the top floor of the carriage house. That's the third location you'll be investigating this evening. But Matilda hasn't checked Molly's room because there's so much going on, why would she be there? You know, but having exhausted all of her efforts, Matilda does climb the steps to Molly's room. And she did find Molly in her room. She did. However, she found Molly in the arms of her husband, Francis. Matilda, so completely devastated at what she had happened upon, she comes back here to her home. She goes up to her room, a floor above us. She goes out to the balcony, and she dove headfirst into the courtyard. She landed in what was described as, quote, a crumpled mess. Now, 2 weeks later, as the family is still mourning the death of their beloved Matilda, they're still trying to cope with this terrible tragedy, and they find Molly. They find her hung from the rafters in her room, the same rafters that remain today. And most think Molly's death was suicide. Some argue murder. Some say, well, maybe Francis had a hand in it. Maybe the business associates. Maybe even the children, blaming her for Matilda's demise. Now, we will never be certain what happened to Molly on this very sad day, but most believe that those two spirits of Molly and Matilda remain here amongst the rest at the Israeli house. Molly has been known to communicate with us during investigations. Matilda is seen sometimes in photographs, especially in the ladies' parlor room. Now, again, you all are more than welcome to try to communicate with Molly and Matilda, but please keep in mind their tragic past. I think that's about all I have to say, folks. You guys ready to start investigating?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Alright, so how about a viewer group of four? If you guys want to stay up in the parlor rooms, you want me to leave the heat on?
No.
Follow me downstairs.
Thank you. you there?
Hello?
No, here, come here, come here. Think again.
Was you? Okay, that one was actually super blurry, but I think the first one was fine. Okay, so that one I took part in our way.
That's cute.
No, I really kind of.
You look like Layla. You know who that is?
Layla?
Layla?
No.
You know, guys, no.
So go with the other one. Other, I thought you took three.
No, I. Oh, yeah, that one's
right. Right there.
Right there. It's
here
just a blurry photo.
You don't see anything.
Wait, go back.
Okay.
Never mind.
Okay.
Yeah,
that's
it. Yeah.
Oh.
I know.
We're not here to make you upset or interfere in your life.
Alright, folks, it is time for our first rotation, so those in the parlor, should we
dislike?
No.
Make that light go out. talking to it? Can you talk through this box that's in my hand?
Do is touch that box and we'll know that you're That's scary as shit.
Come on, we got this, though.
I thought you were wearing your old white shoes.
I have shoes, all white on.
Now,
what
can you do?
Okay.
Did
you
move your foot like this?
Yeah,
because
that's
the
on.
Okay. Whose feet did we just see? If you are a girl, go to the red light. Or touch one of our feet.
Oh, I just saw that.
Too.
There's an orb in here. Y'all saw that too?
Yeah,
I didn't see that time.
Did the white light shine?
I saw it. Did it like came in right?
Yep,
it
came in. Yep. Someone take a picture of the feet under us.
These hands.
That would be insane, Chris. First, everyone. First, that shit. Here, I'll put a light on so y'all can do it first. We're actually catching action! Okay, okay. Are you ready, John? Take sneaks, bro. God, they're gonna hate our recording.
Those in the parlors, you'll be heading downstairs to the lower level. Those in the it'd be great. Also over here, you have a thing called a REM pod, and if you were to touch it like I just did and cover this metal rod, it'll set it off. And then we can talk to each other, and I can ask you questions, or we can play hide and seek. Would you like to play hide and seek?
Yeah. know you're here, and you put your hand on the red light. Thank you. like in one room that we might have heard somebody answer back,
yeah,
know, that they're here, but I'm not 100% sure, you know, maybe hearing the audio, it's hard to tell.
So you did record it?
Yes.
Good.
We had it sitting beside it. We had the recorder sitting, you know, about that far from the voice box.
Oh, good. That's
so
good.
I don't know. We're not sure. A couple of us thought we did, but you know how it is.
Yeah. Always good to question it and go back just in case.
But other than that, for us, I would say it was probably uneventful. I mean, I don't know. Again, I've done some, two or three, and a lot of times you don't see anything, and then you might pick up one or something on your camera when you look
right.
at it later.
Right. Yes, exactly. There's still others
but
to go through. This is not the end.
Just to the naked eye, I can't say that we really saw anything or heard anything odd. Nobody really knocked back at us or anything.
Okay.
We tried to get them to move curtains and, like, little glasses.
What were you going to say?
On the little radio thing. Will it pick up stations?
Yeah, it is picking up
stations. Even it's scanning it. It is.
But it's scanning it, yeah. So it's scanning through real quick.
Yeah, we were in that little hallway.
I thought maybe it was me, but I moved towards the room, and it would, I'd say, let it get, you know, if you don't want me to move, the light would go out. And then I moved back to where I was, like, the three lights come back on.
Huh.
So.
Three lights for you, too?
Yep. And then down in the basement in the surgery room, we're playing the voice recorder back, and there's all, I wasn't moving my hand, nothing, a lot of scratchy noise.
Really?
Yeah. Continually throughout the voice recorder.
Yeah, it's loud.
I don't, Janie, have you ever heard that?
The scratching?
It's a scratching noise.
I heard that at one point, but I don't think it was with your group.
Yeah.
It was with somebody else. We'll have to go back and look at the footage, because I was confused by that. It didn't keep going for a long time. But it was real loud.
Well, on the voice recording, you can hear it throughout the whole, when I'm asking questions, it's scratching. And then I heard it with my ears.
Yeah.
The scratching.
I don't think I've ever heard that before.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a question. Did you smell something when you were in the parlor room?
turned to her and told her I smelled a cigar. And I, in the military, after every mission, we would smoke cigars.
I heard you. I caught all that on footage, and I fully enjoyed watching it. Yeah, because people report that all the time, smelling the cigar smoke. It happens almost like
See, isn't
day.
That cool when you don't know that something's reported,
well,
and then it
yeah.
happens?
Well, what was funny is it happened after I took my hat off. And in the military, you walk in a room, you take your hat off.
Yeah.
And during that time, they would have taken their hats off and placed them in the entryway.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a big history nut, so
cool.
Especially military history. But yeah, so when I took it off, I got the chills in that room as soon as I took it off, and then I smelled the cigar smoke.
That's wild.
Mm-hmm.
Love it. Well, thanks everybody for coming out this evening. I do want to give every group one of these, right? A couple reasons. This has some stuff on it that might be interesting to you, everyone. It has our website, right? You can go to the website. Under Paranormal is a tab that says Evidence. If you click that, that's sort of an archive from the past few years, different photos on there. This has all of our social media as well. And I should leave it there. I was like,
I'm going to eat it.
This has our social media. You can go on the social media. The YouTube is up here. You can find your investigation by the date. Right? The Facebook is up here. There's some photos, all kinds of stuff. All the evidence that I reference is on the social media. You can find that and go through that. You know, probably right before you're about to go to sleep.
Yeah.